You don't want to miss this episode of the AI Show, where Chris Hoder talks about new OpenAI capabilities on Azure. Stay tuned. Hello, and welcome to this episode of the AI Show. Today, I'll be talking with Chris Hoder about the latest OpenAI API. Hi, Chris.
Hey, thanks for
Super happy to have you on the show.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me here. I'm super excited. I'm already jumping in. So Chris, I'm a lead program manager in the Azure OpenAI service, which is one of the new products within the cognitive services that we announced this week at Ignite.
That's awesome. So you already answered my first question. I was going to ask who you are and what you do. Got it. So can you tell us more about OpenAI? What is OpenAI? Some people may not have heard of OpenAI here.
Yeah, OpenAI is a research company that was founded a few years ago, and really they have the core goal and mission to develop an artificial general intelligence. But to do that, you know, with a really responsible way, ensuring that that's done is kind of a core principle of the development. And really since that founding, they've been pushing the cutting edge of what's possible in machine learning and AI. And they've had several kind of breakthroughs on the state of the art, particularly in the language space, but also in other areas like vision and audio.
Yeah, and they're also like one of the most trusted companies, right? I see that a lot in like surveys that people answer, which is very cool. Like in this day and age, that matters a lot. And so can you tell us about the partnership between Microsoft and OpenAI?
Yeah, the partnership with between us and OpenAI has been a multi-year partnership. It really goes back to 2019, where we formally announced the partnership. And that was really based on that shared value of, you know, thinking about trustfulness and responsible use of AI as we develop and bring new technologies forward. And then in late 2020, we kind of re-upped and built on that agreement, where we announced that we were working with OpenAI to take their really powerful kind of state-of-the-art GPT-3 language models and learn how to bring those to market to help, you know, you and our customers leverage those capabilities in new ways. And really, since that announcement, we've started to see that come to fruition, and we've seen it across Microsoft's products. And a couple of the ones that I'm super excited about are, you know, Microsoft's Power Apps, which is in the Power Platform. It's a low-code application development software, and they're using or implementing GPT-3 to really make low-code closer to no-code, where you can just provide your free text information of what you want to do. GPT-3 in the product will convert that to the formula you need in your application. And so it's just kind of making it that much easier and that much more efficient and fast to get to value. The other one, which hopefully we'll demo here shortly, is GitHub's Copilot. It's just such a fantastic tool to kind of really accelerate development and make it just so much easier to get started.
Yeah, I think Power Apps, I think the cool thing is that, you know, we have like a certain number of developers in the world, and Power Apps just extends that number by so much. And just the sheer like power that can comes with that is just crazy, right? Just to think about that.
Yeah, it's awesome. The Power Platform is just like all their products. You can go from idea to something running that you can give to folks in you know, a weekend. If you didn't know anything about the product at the start, it's I think a really big change in the way of how easy it is to build these kinds of applications.
Yeah. So you and your team, you guys have a big announcement for Ignite, right? Do you want to tell us about that?
Yeah. So this week we announced the Azure OpenAI service, which is a product within the cognitive services AI suite, where we are bringing OpenAI's models and API capabilities onto Azure as a first-party service that Microsoft is providing. And you know, if you go to the aka.ms link on the screen, you'll be able to learn more. And really, this was the next step in a journey that started sometime last year, where I should say May last year, where OpenAI released their APIs and their service. That was the first time developers got access to the GPT-3 models, which is a very large language model that's really been setting the state of the art in terms of performance in just many different tasks. And over that year, you know, we learned a lot and we saw a lot. And if you kind of look around, you'll see that customers are discovering hundreds of different ways to use these applications. But what we found was that as companies got further along in that process and started to integrate these models into their core use cases and their mission critical applications, they started to ask and need things like security, compliance, and regulatory requirements. And so that's things like network isolation, managed identity authentication, certification backed guarantees. And all of these things are kind of fundamental in the cloud. It's kind of part of Azure's core DNA. And, you know, our services really strive to provide that to enable the enterprise in the cloud. And so it became more and more evident that, you know, bringing OpenAI's models and Azure closer together was just going to be a really great fit. So that's what we announced here at Ignite, was the Azure OpenAI service, which provides that same functionality on Azure with the security and compliance backing.
That sounds like the perfect partnership for me. Yeah. So I want to see a demo.
Yeah, let's hop into it. So if you guys are following any of the earlier kind of breakout sessions at Ignite, we showed a lot about how customers are applying this in the application side. I wanted to dive into the code and show a little bit more about, you know, the developer experience. And if you're not familiar with GPT-3 or their language models, they have several different kinds, Ada, Babbage, Curie, and DaVinci. DaVinci is their big state-of-the-art one. And the way it works is you just provide free text in and it generates free text out. And that simple approach actually becomes super flexible. And I want to show that here in this demo. And so what you're seeing on the screen is a Python Jupyter notebook running in Visual Studio Code. And I'll just kind of walk you through what we have. And so I'm just have a config file that I'm not showing. And this has the access credentials and URI and things. And then I have a simple method here. And what it's doing is it's wrapping around really one REST API call. And I'm calling the slash completions endpoint on our service. And that's, you know, the meat and potatoes of what the service offers. It's you send the text in, it'll give you back the generated text out. And so in the data payload, there's a prompt, and that's your text input. And then there are a lot of different optimization parameters you can pass to the service. But for early stage iteration and kind of getting started, you don't need to know these. It's super simple. You can just provide text in and you get the text out. So with that, let's hop into the demo. So one of the kind of areas that we're seeing lots of customer interest in ideation and new experiences on using GPT-3 is written, I kind of like to think of it as the blank page problem, right? So how do you help somebody summarize content, rewrite content, generate headlines and things so that you can do that more efficiently, be a copywriter, and do more editing? And so I actually ran into this problem earlier this week when we were writing a blog to announce the service. You need to write a headline for the blog that everyone will see. And so I thought, well, why not let GPT-3 tell us that? And so what you have here in my prompt, I'm just asking the service and the model to create a headline for this article. And that's kind of the beauty of the models and the services. You can talk to it in natural English and it will interpret it and respond back. And so you don't need to have as much knowledge of machine learning and building out data structures and things as you have in some classical methods. And then I provide, you know, a couple of paragraphs on what we're announcing, a paragraph on how the service works, and then a paragraph on response, how to apply it responsibly. And so that's all I'm going to send to the service. And let's see what it sends us back. And so it's a fairly long piece of text. It will take a few seconds to run. And so what we get back is that Azure OpenAI service is the newest addition to the Azure AI portfolio. It provides customers access to OpenAI's GPT-3 and Codex models through simple and intuitive REST APIs.
That's pretty good. Awesome.
Yeah, I think I would use that.
Yeah, I would too. So what would happen if you run it again?
Yeah, it's a great question. So the model is stochastic by design, which means that you're not guaranteed to get the same response time and time again. And so you'll notice very, very similar, but instead of AI portfolio, we got back Azure Cognitive Services. And that actually leads really well into my next demo, where there is a parameter here called temperature, which controls that, you know, variation or randomness. And the higher value you get, the more variation you're going to get on your responses. It's going to look different each time. And so something like headlines, you might find that there's a lot of qualitative, subjective evaluation you want to do. And so you might not want one, you might want five. And so one thing you can do is you can increase that temperature, get some more variation, and then increase the number that that is returned. And so instead of returning the most likely response, you can return the top five. And so what you can see here is I went and ran that. And so now we got five different variations and we can kind of read through them where we have, you know, what we saw in the earlier one with the Azure AI portfolio. We got a blank. Sometimes it'll just return blank. So it's something you need to, when you're looking at application development, you'd want to handle. Azure OpenAI service is now in preview. Maybe not the most engaging, but could still work.
It's pretty good.
Yeah. And so then this fifth one, you can see it's kind of gone off in a very different direction on the fifth one. So that's kind of shows you when you increase the temperature, you'll get more interesting, but potentially kind of maybe not what you were looking for.
Yeah, it's good.
Cool. So I did have a second example here, which is going to use the same endpoint, but we're going to do a completely different task to show you that general generalizability of the model. And so because it's free text in, that actually makes it really easy to adapt to new tasks because you can just kind of provide it different context. And so, you know, here we can imagine we want to extract airport codes in a comma separated list. And what you can do, again, tell it what you want, and then you can show it what you want. And it's going to analyze what you've shown it and use that for pattern matching so that it'll follow up in a more accurate and consistent response. And so here I have two examples of what I want. I want the text input and then the codes back. So I want to fly from Los Angeles to Miami, respond with LAX and MIA. So provide two of those, and then we're going to predict flying from Orlando to Portland. And so I don't know if you happen to know what the airport codes for either one are.
I'm terrible at those things. I mean, if you put Seattle there, I might know, but that's really about it.
Yeah, these are two of the more interesting ones because Orlando is actually MCO and Portland is PWM.
Yeah, would not have guessed that.
So let's send it to the model and we get back PWM and MCO.
Very cool. Very cool.
And if you were developing this, right, so you would continue to send these examples and you would just change your text. And so we could send Boston as well and we'll get back MCO in Boston.
Very cool. Yeah. All right. Well, this was just amazing. I think everyone will agree with me that this is just so exciting. Like just even just 2 years ago, like you couldn't imagine this kind of work being done. It's just great. But you know, recently there's been a lot of like focus on like using technology responsibly, and especially these large models. So can you tell us what we're doing to help people use this technology responsibly?
Yeah, it's a great question. And I think you can see that this model in particular, right, they are very generally can be applied to multiple different tasks and things. And so it becomes really important that you design your solutions with it so that it can be used responsibly. And so, you know, we start with the core principles that we have at Microsoft, and then we start to look at, you know, how can we get customer, what is the benefit a customer can get? What are the harms? And how do we enable the benefits while mitigating the harms? And so that, we're looking at lots of different areas. It's, you know, product tools and guidance that we're looking to provide. And so things like how do we design in from the start content filters and things that will help the developers of the application ensure that their customers don't use it in unintended ways. And then as well providing guidance and how to best develop and use the service.
That makes a lot of sense. So where can people go to find out more about this?
Yeah, so people can go to the AI blog that was shown earlier. We just popped up. Yes, aka.ms/openaiservice blog. And then as well, if you go to Azure or the azure.microsoft.com, we have a product page up there now.
Awesome. Great. Well, thank you. Thank you for all of that. I think this is just super exciting. I don't think I'm the only one to think that. So thank you for being on the show.
Yeah, no, thanks for having me. I'm hoping I will be back very soon with lots of new features to show you guys.
We'll have you back. You have my word on that. So in this episode, you learn about the new OpenAI cognitive service on Azure, and you saw how you can use it to summarize text and generate new text. Thank you for watching, and hopefully we'll see you next time.